I'm gonna show you how to do this. Cause it's so sweet.
We have made it to In Heat, Black and Blue's fourth studio album. And this is a promotional copy that I found at a local record shop. I was so happy when I found this. This was the last of the Black and Blue albums that I was able to find on vinyl. And wow. Was not expecting that. Okay, so according to Wikipedia, In Heat is the fourth studio album by the American glam metal band Black and Blue. It was produced by Kiss bassist Gene Simmons, just like the previous album, Nasty Nasty, was. Professional ratings of In Heat include All Music, which gave it 2 out of 5, or 4 out of 10, of course, stars. Collector's Guide to Heavy Metal, which gives it 4 out of 10 stars. And Rock Hard, which gave it 6 out of 10 stars. In any case, not real high rankings. Okay, so 10 songs produced by Gene on Geffen Records. So, Black and Blue's fourth album. The second produced by Kiss's Gene Simmons. The second with John Kalodner as the band's A&R man. And basically the same exact result as before, an album that had no hits, didn't break into the top 100 on the charts, and was the end, in this case, of the band's recording career, at least for some time to come. Geffen paid for the album, paid for the tour, and evidently then decided, after doing all that, there was really no point in paying for a music video to at least attempt to promote the album in order to get some sort of return on their investment. In 1988, when damn near any band who had guitars and long hair was getting airplay and selling 1 million albums. Are you freaking kidding me? What gives, Geffen? How does that make sense? Now, if you haven't heard it, find this album on YouTube, folks. It's right here on my channel, so you don't have to go to very much trouble. Just go down in the description below this video, and there will be a link to take you directly to the full album playlist. Go to my channel. Click the word playlist up at the top, and boom, there it is. Black and Blue In Heat. 10 tracks. When you go to the playlist, they will play in the order they came in on the album. And what will you find out when you listen to them? You'll find out that this is a pretty great freaking album in 1988. Okay, so in case you don't remember, what else did we get that year? How about now, I know what you're thinking, and you're right. In Heat may not hold up real well next to Operation Mindcrime, But you tell me what does. I certainly think In Heat can stand toe-to-toe with several of those other albums I just mentioned. As a big fan of this band, though, I will also admit that I can understand any number of differing opinions being possible with this album. On the surface, it sounds like it could be the very best Black and Blue album that ever got made. It sounds like the very best production job Gene Simmons ever did, and maybe the best basic production Black and Blue ever got. And what I mean by that is mostly just the way it's recorded. This instrumentation just sounds crisp and tight and smooth and powerful. At least it does to me. It could also be considered the most consistent overall batch of songs on any Black and Blue album. For that matter, one of the most consistent albums I can remember ever hearing by any band. However, that can be looked at in a couple of different ways. A, you could hear it as a big blur of songs that are similar enough you can barely remember them as separate pieces of music at all 10 minutes after you put the album away. Or, A, a bunch of consistent rockers, no ballad. Basically, the first eight are a bunch of really well-recorded party songs, with the final two tracks being just as well-recorded, but slightly darker in mood. And you may think all that is just great and exactly what you're after, which is what I believe I thought when this album came out. And if you choose that second option, you can skip ahead to the song ratings. As for the first option, I mean, listen to them. Those first eight tracks, and even the last two. They're all very mid-tempo, almost sound like half of them could be in the same key, whether they are or not. It's almost like they kept writing the same song, hoping that if they tried hard enough, they would at least get one of them on MTV or radio and people would finally give them more of a chance. Because if somebody liked that one, since most of the songs are basically the same, they would like the whole album and you could party to the whole thing. And seriously, who could possibly blame those people if they did feel that way? I couldn't. And if you chose that option, I don't know whether Gene's to blame for that or the record company, meaning John Kalodner, of course, or the band. Somebody is, if you consider it something blame should be assigned to rather than praise. And to this day, I'm not actually sure which it really is. Sometimes I put this album on and think, man, that's fantastic. I'm so glad they got to make an album that really shows off how much their songwriting had matured by this point. And other times I put it on and I think, it is kind of the same idea 10 slightly different ways. But I'm going to listen to it anyway because I love this band and I love that idea. Imagine how crushed they must have been when, after all that hard work and honing their playing and songwriting, Live It Up was the only single released from the album and didn't even get a video. Again, why, Geffen? Why? What excuse can you possibly have, especially in 1988, after both Whitesnake and Appetite for Destruction have broken so hugely, and you're literally raking in what has to be tons of money from those albums and tours and merchandise? Well, Video or no video, In Heat sounds fabulous to me. And certain songs can really stand out as a lot of fun to listen to, while others, between those, don't dip all that much in their appeal. All right, so first, the album cover. I like the orange-reddish color. Obviously, it makes sense with the title In Heat. Now, what about joining the late 80s trend of having the band appear on the cover without a stitch of clothing to be seen? That happened a lot in the 80s. Thank goodness the photographer wasn't shorter, though, huh? Okay, so let's get into these tracks. Track one, Rock On. Written by Gene Simmons, Jaime St. James, and Tommy Thayer. 5 stars. All right. No delay, no intro section, just right into the cheesy goodness that is 1988 Black and Blue. Really good album opener. It gets you going. Makes you wonder what the rest of the tracks are going to be like, which is what I think you want if you're the band and the label. It's not super heavy. It's not very fast-paced. That could actually be a bit of a drawback for some people, I suppose. It's more laid-back than energetic. Only you can decide how you feel about that. But either way, I think it's a pretty good tune. Track 2, Sight for Sore Eyes. You can take my money, don't got a lot. Just need this woman who somehow got lost. Like Cinderella, she come alive. Just about midnight, she's the queen of my eyes. Written by Simmons, St. James, Thayer, and Pat Regan. 4 stars. Okay. And right away, this track sounds a bit different than anything on the earlier albums. That may be because it's one of the 2 tracks produced by Pat Regan instead of Gene Simmons. It sounds a bit more electronic than what we've been used to from these guys in the past. In case you aren't familiar with Pat Regan, among other credits, he engineered some stuff for the 2001 Kiss box set, the LA Guns Hollywood Vampires album, and Kiss's Hot in the Shade, among many others, and also helped Gene produce, engineer, and mix Keel's The Right to Rock album. He also played keyboards on Quiet Riot's Metal Health and Condition Critical albums and has also worked many times with acts such as Weird Al, Rainbow, Deep Purple, Warrant, and Mr. Big. I'm going to go ahead and venture a guess that the different sound of this track and track number 4 have a lot to do with Pat Regan's keyboards and composition. And that's okay. They aren't super wimpy keyboards, and the songs are pretty good. It does give both tracks a slightly more commercial overall feel than the rest of the band's catalog, I'd say, but doesn't do so by totally taking their personality out of the songs. Track 3, Heat It Up, Burn It Out. Written by St. James, Thayer, and Jeff Warner. 5 stars. I've always loved the beginning of this song. Great beat, great rhythm, great guitar riff. It sort of loses me just a little bit with the verses, but gets me right back with the chorus every time. At this point, now on the last of the band's classic album catalog, I feel I have to make some comparison between Jaime St. James' vocals. On the debut album, I like his voice and love what he does with it on those songs, but he sort of always sounds like he has a cold or something, or maybe like he's a Muppet.
So you think you'll take another piece of me to satisfy your intellectual need? Gonna bring you down, cause you've been pushing me. You gotta recognize my superiority.
I meant to say that a few reviews ago and forgot to, but I think he got rid of whatever part of that was maybe annoying to some people by the second album. And it's definitely totally gone to me for these last two records. Maybe you'll feel differently about that. Let me know. Track 4, Suspicious.
Where do you go when the sun goes down? I believe in working it out. You keep running around. Well, I won't bother you if you don't bother me. So let me be your number one or put me out of misery.
Written by St. James, Thayer, and Regan again. 4 stars. And yeah, you can basically just rewind the video to see what I said about track number 2 and apply it to track 4 too. Cool song, still black and blue, but a definite change in overall flavor. And honestly, you could have said the same thing about 2 of the tracks on Nasty Nasty. Those being Does She or Doesn't She and I'll Be There for You. This is what's known as the powers that be trying to force a band to grow in a more commercial direction, boys and girls. I'm not necessarily saying it was a bad thing. I'm just not sure it was a great one. But at this point, I also feel obligated to tell you that track 2, Sight for Sore Eyes, is the most viewed song from this album on my channel, with a total of 2.7 thousand views. So what do I know? Some of my audience sure enjoys that song enough to seek it out. Track 5, The Snake.
Coming up on me high.
written by St. James and Thayer. 5 stars. Okay, this sounds more like a black and blue song to me. Also, like Gene had more influence instead of Pat Regan, which is true. I really like the verses here. As with most black and blue songs, fantastic vocal melodies. It's not a favorite track from the album, but it's good enough to get that 5th star from me. Definitely sounds like it could have been on Nasty Nasty just as easily. Now we flip the record over to side 2. Track 6, Live It Up. Written by Simmons, St. James, and Jeff Warner. 5 stars. Okay, and here's the only single released from this album. No video, as I said, but it was the single. Great song. Definitely my favorite from the album. Again, if it's black and blue, it's gonna have great guitars, a fantastic vocal melody, and a chorus that makes you want to jump around, bang your head, and scream while everyone else at the party stares at you and wonders what you've been snorting and why you didn't offer them some. And as a bonus, it's got that line borrowed directly from Gene's Trial by Fire lyric on the Asylum album. I've only got one life to live. I'm gonna live it up. What could be better? Track 7, Give Me Your Love. There's a train that's coming and I'm overdue. Written by Adam Mitchell, Jaime St. James, and Tommy Thayer. 4 stars. All right, co-written with Adam Mitchell. Nice. I'm not sure I love it, but I do really like it. A lot of great parts here. Okay, well then, why not 5 stars instead of 4? I'm not sure. I'm really not. Maybe if you catch me on a different day, all of these songs could get 5 stars. But I kind of doubt it. Track 8, Get Wise to the Rise, written by Jaime St. James and Tommy Thayer. We'll be right back. 5 stars. That is a great intro riff. I have to say, there are several spoken parts on this album where I can't tell if it's Gene Simmons talking or Jaime St. James. I just have no idea. Why does that matter? It probably doesn't. This may be my favorite song about an erection ever. But golly, just so many to choose from, especially if you're a Kiss fan, right? Track 9, Great Guns of Fire. Written by Jaime St. James and Tommy Thayer. 4 stars. Okay, a little faster tempo, a little darker riffing, a little more aggressive sounding vocal maybe. I do like the song quite a bit. I just don't think I've ever truly loved it as much as some of the others. But I think it also proves my earlier point about the album, that depending on your viewpoint, there's not a weak track to be found, unless you think that you're just sort of hearing basically the same track over and over again, in which case, by this point, you may have tuned out. Track 10, Stranger.
Watch my fingers burn like a flame I never learned. I burn myself to the end.
Written by Gene Simmons and Jaime St. James. 4 stars. And just when I've said that, finally a song that sounds different. If this is the power ballad on this album, this may be the album for a lot of you who don't care for power ballads. Slower, darker, a little acoustic guitar, but hardly a love song. I really dig this track. If I was going to go with a 5th star for any of these 4-star songs, it could have been this one, or Sight for Sore Eyes. But no, I think they're both pretty firmly 4 stars in my book. Okay, so what's the bottom line? Depending on your mood, if you feel one way, you could switch almost any of those song ratings around any day because they're basically all the same song. I hate saying that. I really do, because I love these guys. And just like the other 3, I love this album. But I also can't help but notice that it doesn't vary very much from start to finish. And I would have preferred that it maybe did that a little more. But either way, that's 45 total stars for the songs divided by 10 songs, which of course equals a 4.5 star rating for the album, technically tying it with the debut. Now, if you don't remember how to do math, because like me, there's a little too much beer in your life, I asked for help and was told that in an album ranking, it would have meant In Heat and the debut are tied. Okay, so I have to break that tie now. So do I actually feel like In Heat is the equal of the debut? Yes and no. I do feel it's superior in some of the obvious ways. Ways you can hear right away, like sound quality. And I could certainly understand if anyone else felt In Heat is superior to the debut. But for me, it comes down to nostalgia and personality. And based on that stuff, I have to give the tiebreaker to the debut album. Mostly because it's just such a unique collection of songs. So my official overall ranking for Black and Blue winds up looking like this. Now, you can argue for whichever album you prefer, and I won't begrudge you your choice at all. Because honestly, I think the overall point of all this is that no matter what you may have said should have been higher or lower compared to the others, all four albums are rated really high for me. And I think we all know that sometimes these rankings work out perfectly, and sometimes they don't. But I really can't complain here. I honestly think I would have Nasty Nasty ranked above In Heat if I were just ranking them off the top of my head. But as I think we've probably all seen from past reviews I've done, the songs make up the albums and the songs don't lie. That said, it really doesn't matter. I love all four of these albums, probably as much as almost any other band's 80s catalog. I do. And the only real differentiation I can make is that I love Without Love a little bit more than any of the others. As for my hopes, I hope that after hearing these albums, if you hadn't before, you'll get to know them and love them too. That's been the whole point of these four review videos, after all, just to turn you on to Black and Blue if you hadn't been already. Now, a few of you, Coleman76 and Starman2112, mentioned the most recent Black and Blue album, Hell Yeah, in comments on earlier videos I've done here. And I do plan to finally listen to that album in its entirety as soon as possible, and will probably review it once I've had time to really absorb it and let it settle a little bit. And thanks for reminding me that I need to do that. All right, folks, take care. I'll see you again soon. Out.
And I shall hear the soft, soft above me. Oh, Danny boy, I love you so.